Good morning, children.
Good morning, ma'am.
So we were discussing about Z scheme of light reaction in the previous period. Hope you have understood. I want you to quickly summarize the different steps involved in Z scheme, because when you are going to learn the next topic, like chemiosmotic hypothesis, the same Z scheme applications are coming, or it is related, it is very closely associated. If you haven't understood Z scheme, you will not understand chemiosmotic hypothesis. So quickly summarize, what have you understood? Yes, Anna, you may start.
The Z scheme is the electron transport system is when PS2 absorbs 680 nanometer wavelength.
What is PS2?
PS2 is photosystem
2. The reaction center will absorb light of wavelength
680 nanometer.
And once the light energy is absorbed, what will happen then next?
Electrons are excited and transfer to an electron acceptor.
Okay, enough. Then what happens, Evelyn? This has reached an electron acceptor. What is next?
The electron acceptor will pass it to a chain of electron transport system.
Electron transport chain. And this movement, you can call it as what type of movement?
Downhill
movement. So in terms of redox potential, so when it is moving from lower to higher redox potential, you call it as a downhill movement. And when this happens, what is released? Evelyn, what is released? When the downhill movement takes place, what is released?
Energy.
Utilizing this energy, which molecule is synthesized?
NADPH. NADPH.
No. Just ATP. See the figure. ATP. ATP molecule is synthesized. So utilizing the energy, an ATP molecule will be synthesized. And then what happens? Vidur, what is next?
The electrons are transferred to photosystem 1.
Your headset or microphone, something you changed?
No.
A very crystal clear voice. Okay. Continue.
And there also light will be absorbed of 700 nanometer.
No, the electrons from the electron transport chain. Electrons will move through the electron transport chain. Then where it will reach, I didn't hear.
PS1.
And from PS1, once it has reached PS1, next. Continue.
Electrons are excited.
Electrons are excited upon receiving. When do they get excited?
They absorb light.
Of which wavelength?
700 nanometer.
And they get excited. And what will happen to the electrons? Sania, what will happen to the electrons released from PS1?
Ma'am, I was not there in the morning section.
Steffi?
Ma'am was not there in the morning session.
Malavika?
They move downhill.
To where?
To a molecule of NADP+.
First of all, they will be taken up by an electron acceptor. From PS1, the electrons will be transferred to an electron acceptor. From there, it will move downhill to... Malavika, once again repeat.
Move downhill to a molecule of NADP.
And it will get reduced to?
NADPH+.
Okay. And then next step, what is happening is photolysis of water, splitting of water will take place in presence of light. So let us see that. The electrons that are removed from PS2 must be replaced. So in the beginning we saw that the electrons present in photosystem 2 will get excited and they will be reaching PS1, and from PS1 they'll reach NADP, making it reduced. Upon receiving the electrons, NADP will get reduced to NADPH2. So electrons are lost from photosystem 2. So these electrons which are removed from photosystem 2 must be replaced. So this replacement of the electrons take place by the electrons released by the splitting of water. So we already learned that when light falls on photosystem 2, it will get the electrons there get excited and they will move to an electron acceptor. From there, they will move downhill to through electron transport chain and finally reaches photosystem 1. From photosystem 1, they'll simultaneously they get excited upon receiving light of wavelength 700 nanometer. From there, they'll be transferred to electron acceptor, from electron acceptor to NADP, making it reduced. So the electrons are lost. It's not coming back to PS2. It started from PS2, but it's not coming back to PS2. But we need to compensate for the loss of electrons. So for that, splitting of water takes place. So water splitting complex in PS2, it is located on the inner side of thylakoid membrane. Hope you are remembering what is thylakoid, what is stroma, lamella, and also granum. I'll repeat, or I'll show you the diagram once again. So this is the structure of a chloroplast, and we have so many disc-shaped or coin-shaped structures. Each one you call it is thylakoid. And a stack of a pile of thylakoids, you call it is granum. This is thylakoid. Whereas a stack of thylakoids, you call us granum. And interconnecting the thylakoids present in different granum, there is stroma lamella. Stroma. All these we had learned before. Then there is a matrix present, you call it as stroma. Okay. You call it a stroma. So this we had already learned. And here it is mentioned, the water splitting complex is located on the inner side of thylakoid membrane. So this one you can take as a single thylakoid. A single thylakoid. So here inside there are so many arranged one above the other, but just one. So this is a single thylakoid. So here there'll be stroma outside because thylakoids are present in the stroma in a matrix. And it is in the membranes of these thylakoid or located on the inner side of the membrane, the water splitting complex is present. So water splitting complex is present where the water splitting or where the photolysis of water takes place is situated on the inner side of the thylakoid membrane. This is thylakoid, just one we have enlarged. So this one is granum with so many thylakoids. Just one thylakoid is shown over here, and the water splitting complex is situated on the inner side. So this is a lumen. Lumen means the space inside. This is a lumen or the space inside. This is a membrane of thylakoid. And outside you can see the stroma, because as such it is present in these stacks of thylakoids or grana are located in the stroma. Okay. So coming back to our topic, the water splitting complex in PS2 is located on the inner side of the thylakoid membrane. And when photolysis of water takes place, water will be split into protons or hydrogen ions, same as protons, 4H+, oxygen molecule, 4 electrons. So these are the products of photolysis of water or splitting of water. When water splits, we get protons, oxygen and electrons. Protons, oxygen and electrons, and these electrons will enter photosystem 2 to compensate for the loss of electrons. Electrons produced as a result of photolysis of water will enter photosystem 2 to compensate for the loss of electrons, whereas the protons, these will be used or utilized to convert NADP into NADPH along with the electrons which it receives from the electron carrier. Hope you are remembering from photosystem 1, it gets electrons get excited, received by an electron carrier, then it will move downhill to NADP. So along with the electrons, protons are also necessary to convert NADP into NADPH plus H plus. Okay, for that conversion, protons are needed. So protons will be utilized for that, electrons will compensate for the loss, and oxygen will be released out, it will diffuse out. Oxygen is liberated as a byproduct of photosynthesis. The electrons needed to replace those removed from PS1 are provided by PS2. That we already saw. The electrons which are released from PS1. The electrons which are released from, you want to see that once again? See, many were absent during last period. So I'll repeat it once I complete this. Okay. The electrons released from photosystem 1. Electrons will be released from photosystem 1 as well as photosystem 2. It begins from photosystem 2. Electrons will get excited upon receiving energy, and from photosystem 2, they'll move to an electron carrier, electron acceptor. From the electron acceptor, it moves through electron transport chain, and finally it is reaching photosystem 1. So it will help in replacing the electrons which are lost by photosystem 1. Whereas the electrons released by photolysis of water will compensate for the loss of electrons from photosystem 2, whereas the protons released will be useful in reducing NADP to NADPH, and the oxygen will be released out, and electrons will compensate for the loss of electrons from photosystem 2. I don't know how far you have understood, especially those who were not there. Photophosphorylation. Before starting chemiosmotic hypothesis, the next important topic, I'll be explaining Z scheme once again. The synthesis of ATP by cells in mitochondria as well as in chloroplast, you call it as photophosphorylation. And it is a synthesis of, see, phosphorylation, just phosphorylation means synthesize of ATP by cells. Photophosphorylation means when that is taking place in presence of light in chloroplast, you call it as photophosphorylation. It occurs in two ways, cyclic and non-cyclic. And Z scheme of light reaction that we already discussed is non-cyclic photophosphorylation. So I'm repeating again. Phosphorylation means the synthesis of ATP by cells. That is known as phosphorylation. Synthesis of ATP by cells is phosphorylation. But photophosphorylation means synthesis of ATP from ADP. Okay, synthesis of ATP taking place in chloroplast in presence of light. When it takes place in presence of light, you call it as photophosphorylation. There are two types of photophosphorylation. One is known as cyclic, the other one is non-cyclic. Non-cyclic is what we discussed already, Z scheme of light reaction, and cyclic we need to learn. Let's start with cyclic photophosphorylation. Cyclic photophosphorylation takes place in stroma lamellae. Hope you are remembering what is meant by stroma lamellae. Stroma lamellae will interconnect the thylakoids of different grana. And it is taking place, cyclic photophosphorylation is taking place in location you should know, stroma lamellae, and there only one photosystem will be functional, whereas non-cyclic photophosphorylation takes place when both photosystems 1 and 2 when they work in series, then you call it as non-cyclic. But in cyclic only one is functional. The electron is circulated within the photosystem and ATP synthesis occurs due to the cyclic flow of electrons. Electrons are not escaping out anywhere. They keep on cycling within the photosystem. See here, you can see only one photosystem is involved, from here to the electron acceptor, then through the electron transport chain back to the photosystem, again from here it gets excited, goes to the electron acceptor, travels down the electron transport chain, comes back to the system again, photosystem again. So it is a cyclic flow of electrons, and ATP is being synthesized utilizing the energy released by the transport of electrons. So you call it a cyclic flow because electrons are not going anywhere, it follows a cycle. It's not escaping, it just follows a cycle, and you can find cyclic flow of electrons, and hence the name cyclic photophosphorylation. Okay, the lamellae of grana have got, you know what is grana? Grana means a stack of thylakoids. Lamellae of grana has got both PS1 and PS2, but in stroma lamellae only PS1 is functional. And there the electrons keep on circulating within the photosystem. ATP synthesis takes place as a result of the cyclic flow of electrons. The stroma lamellae, even though it is found in the lamellae of grana or in the thylakoid membranes, both photosystems are present, but in stroma lamellae only PS1 is present. It lacks PS2 and also NADP reductase. NADP reductase is an enzyme which help in converting NADP to NADPH. So both are absent in stroma lamellae. And the site of cyclic photophosphorylation is stroma lamellae. Here only one photosystem, that is one, photosystem one, only that is functional. Photosystem two, as well as NADP reductase, the enzyme necessary for reducing NADP to NADPH2, both are absent. The electron doesn't pass on to NADP. Because in Z scheme of light reaction, we already learned, finally, towards the end, the electrons will be transferred to from photosystem 1, it will go to electron acceptor. From electron acceptor, it will be moving towards NADP. But here, NADP reductase enzyme is not there. So the conversion of NADP to NADPH2 will not take place. So here in cyclic photophosphorylation, electrons are not moving to NADP. From here, in Z scheme, from here, that is from photosystem 1, it moved to NADP molecule. It will move to NADP molecule from photosystem 1 when in the case of Z scheme or non-cyclic photophosphorylation. But here this movement is not there. Instead, it will be cycled back to like this. It will be cycled back to photosystem 1 through electron transport chain. So from here the excited electrons From here, the excited electrons will be taken up by electron acceptor. But if you, those who were present in the previous period, if you remember, you will get that these, from these electron acceptor, they move to NADP. But here, that step is not there. Instead, it is coming back again to where, from where it started, through an electron transport chain. Hence, only ATP is synthesized, no NADPH plus H plus or NADPH2 is not synthesized. Cyclic photophosphorylation also occurs when light of wavelength beyond 680 nanometer are available. So, only when the light below that, the wavelength of light is more than 680, only when that is available also, a cyclic photophosphorylation can take place. So cyclic photophosphorylation takes place when light of wavelength beyond 680 nanometer is only available, nothing less than that. So in that cases also, you can find cyclic photophosphorylation takes place. So I'll be repeating it once again. There are two types of phosphorylation, means synthesis of ATP by cells. But when the synthesis of ATP is taking place in presence of light in the chloroplast, you call it as photophosphorylation. Two types, cyclic and non-cyclic. In non-cyclic photophosphorylation, the electrons lost, or the electrons transferred from the photosystems are not coming back to the photosystems again, but they are replacing electrons by some other means. But the electrons which are released from the photosystems will never come back. That is why you call it as non-cyclic. But whereas in cyclic photophosphorylation, the electrons will be cycled within the photosystems. It will not escape out of the photosystems. So as I told, there are two types, non-cyclic and cyclic. We'll start with cyclic photophosphorylation. And it is, where is it taking place? Taking place in the stroma lamellae. Very important location is very important. Stroma lamellae. And what is special there? There only one photosystem is present. But in non-cyclic photophosphorylation, both photosystems are present and they work in series. Non-cyclic photophosphorylation is same as Z scheme. We already covered it. And here only one photosystem is functional. And here the electrons will get circulated within the photosystem, and utilizing the cyclic flow of electrons, ATP will be released. And the grana lamellae, grana means stack of thylakoids, there both photosystems are present, but here they have only one photosystem. Photosystem 2 as well as NADP reductase enzyme are absent. The electron doesn't pass on to NADP. In non-cyclic photophosphorylation, we saw that the electrons, excited electrons released from photosystem 1 will finally reach NADP, reducing it to NADPH2. But here, the electrons will not pass to NADP, but it will be cycled back. So instead of going to NADP, it will be cycled back to the photosystem through electron transport chain. As a result, only ATP, no NADPH is synthesized, no NADPH2 is synthesized. Cyclic photophosphorylation occurs only when light of wavelength beyond 680 nanometer are available. So before we proceed to non-cyclic chemiosmotic hypothesis, I'll explain non-cyclic photophosphorylation once again. So we have learned what is meant by cyclic photophosphor relation. Non-cyclic photophosphor relation, we have already dealt in detail, that comes in the Z scheme of light reaction. That is what is known as non-cyclic photophosphor relation. Here what you need to note down are following points. One is that here both photosystems are functional. Photosystem 1, photosystem 2, both of them are functional and they work in a series. They work in a series through an electron transport chain. Both of them, starting with the PS2 and then PS1, both will work in series through an electron transport chain. And the next point is that here not only ATP, NADPH plus H plus are also synthesized. Third point here, the electrons which are lost by photosystem 2 do not come back. So electrons which are lost from the photosystem will not come back to the photosystem again, but it will be passed on to NADP. So these three points, if you are asked to write the differences between cyclic and non-cyclic photophosphor relation, you should know these points. So in a cyclic photophosphor relation, only photosystem one is functional, whereas in non-cyclic photophosphor relation, both photosystems are functional. Photosystem 2, photosystem 1, both are functional and they work in series through an electron transport chain. Okay. Second point, in cyclic photophosphor relation, only ATP is synthesized, whereas in non-cyclic photophosphor relation, both ATP and NADPH plus H plus or NADPH2, both of them are synthesized. Okay. And third point, in cyclic photophosphor relation, electrons will be circulating within the photosystem. It's not escaping out. It will be circulated within the photosystem. From the photosystem 1, electrons get excited, go to electron acceptor. Again, it will be coming back to photosystem 1 through an electron transport chain. So the electron cyclic flow of electrons you can find, but where is in in non-cyclic photophosphor relation, electrons which are lost, they are not coming back to photosystem, but it will be passed on to NADP, making it reduced to NADPH2. Okay, these are some of the major differences between cyclic and non-cyclic photophosphor relation. And non-cyclic photophosphor relation, we even call it a Z scheme because of its characteristic zigzag or Z shape. And such a shape we get when these are arranged, when the carriers, electron carriers, are arranged in the sequence of their redox potential. So it's very important to know what is meant by Z scheme. For those who were absent last period, quickly I will tell you what is meant by Z scheme before proceeding to the next topic. Okay, so this is electron transport system or Z scheme of light reaction or non-cyclic photophosphor relation. So let's see what is happening here. And those who were there during the first period, if some points were not clear, please do listen. Okay. Photosystem 1. This is the light harvesting complex of photosystem 1. See here, you can see photosystem 2, photosystem 1. Photosystem 2 is placed first. So first of all, what happens is the reaction sender of photosystem 2 will be receiving light of wavelength 680 nanometer, whereas that of photosystem 1 will be absorbing light of wavelength 700 nanometer. So when light falls on photosystem 2, or when photosystem 2 absorbs light of wavelength 680 nanometer, the electrons present here will get excited and they will be transferred to an electron acceptor. From the electron acceptor, they will be moving through electron transport system. So they'll be moving downhill to the electron transport system. Downhill movement means when the electrons, they are moving from a lower redox potential to higher redox potential, you call it as downhill movement. Downhill movement means the movement of electrons from lower redox potential to higher redox potential. So when this happens, they will release energy. Using this energy, an ATP molecule will be synthesized. Once again, photosystem 2, they will absorb red light of wavelength 680 nanometer. Upon receiving, upon absorbing light, the electrons get excited. They will be transferred to electron acceptor. And from the electron acceptor, they'll move downhill to an electron transport system. Downhill movement means movement from lower to higher redox potential. This will release energy. Using that energy, one ATP molecule will be synthesized from ADP and an inorganic phosphate. ADP is adenosine diphosphate, only two phosphate molecule. So when one more phosphate molecule joins with that, it becomes three phosphate molecules, and you call it as ATP or adenosine triphosphate. From the electron transport chain, again, they will move to the photosystem 1. They'll be moving to photosystem 1. So this indicates photosystem 1. So after moving through electron transport chain, they'll be transferred to photosystem 1. So the electrons from photosystem 2 will finally reach photosystem 1. And as I told you, this will help in compensating for the electrons which are lost from PS1 when light is falling on photosystem 2 and electrons getting excited simultaneously. Here also excitement and absorption of light energy and excitement of electron takes place at the same time. So when this is getting excited, they will receive light of wavelength 700 nanometer. The electrons get excited, move to an electron acceptor. And the electrons which are coming from photosystem 2, after passing through the electron transport chain, they'll reach here and they will compensate for the loss of electrons from this photosystem 1. And once these electrons are transferred to the electron acceptor, from there they will move to NADP molecule and reduce it to NADPH plus H plus. Okay, are you following, children? Those who were not there, photosystem 2, they will absorb light of wavelength 680 nanometer. Upon receiving light or absorbing light, the electrons will get excited. And what will happen? Once the electrons are excited, they will be transferred to an electron acceptor. And from the electron acceptor, they will move through an electron transport system. Electron transport system, here they have shown as a single complex. Actually, it involves several complexes like plastocyanin, plastoquinone, then cytochrome B6, F, etc. All that is not required. So they have not mentioned. They have just mentioned as a single complex electron transport chain. So starting from here, electrons reach here. From there, through the electron transport system, they'll finally reach photosystem, light harvesting complex of photosystem 1. So when the excitement of the electrons, absorption of light energy and excitement of electrons is taking place in photosystem 1, simultaneously here also the same process are taking place. The electrons will get excited and they will move to electron acceptor, and this from the electron acceptor they'll move to NADP to reduce it to NADPH. But the electrons which are reaching from the photosystem 2 through the electron transport chain will compensate for this loss of electrons from photosystem 1. Any doubt I'm not getting any response. Children, are you following?
Yes,
ma'am. Okay. No, those who were present, for them it is easy to understand. I'm worried about others. Then from the electron acceptor, they'll be moving to NADP, and these electrons, the electrons which are passed on to NADP is not coming back to photosystem 2. Electrons have started moving from here, but it's not reaching back to it, but it will be reaching photosystem 1. And those electrons which are lost will never come back, but this is compensated by the splitting of water. When water is split, electrons are released, protons are also released, and oxygen. And oxygen will diffuse out. These protons are needed for reducing NADP to NADPH along with the electrons. And these electrons will go back to photosystem 2 to compensate for the loss of electrons. And photosystem 1, already the compensation is carried out with the help of the electrons reaching from photosystem 2 through electron transport chain. So we call this as non-cyclic photophosphorylation. And this is also known as Z scheme because of its peculiar shape. See, Z, if you check only the red arrows, that yellow color indicates a light falling. So you can find this characteristic Z pattern or zigzag pattern, and you call it a Z scheme of light reaction. So points to be noted when compared to cyclic photophosphorylation is that in cyclic photophosphorylation, only one photosystem is involved, and in non-cyclic photophosphorylation, two photosystems involved and they work in series. Second point, in cyclic photophosphorylation, only ATP is synthesized. Whereas in non-cyclic photophosphorylation, both ATP and NADPH are synthesized. And third point, the electrons are not escaping out. Instead, it is carrying out, following a cyclic flow within the photosystem in the case of cyclic photophosphorylation. That is why the name cyclic photophosphorylation. Whereas in the case of non-cyclic photophosphorylation, the electrons which are lost to NADP, which are passed on to NADP, will never come back to photosystem again, and they compensate for the loss with the help of splitting of water or photolysis of water, and the electrons released will compensate for the loss of electrons in photosystem 2, and the loss of electrons from photosystem 1 is compensated with the electrons reaching photosystem 1 from photosystem 2 through electron transport chain. Have you understood? I know so many photosystem transport, this, that. Have you understood? Any doubt? I am ready to. Those who were absent, Steffi, then who else? Somebody was there. Michael, have you understood? Steffi, yes. You read and will you find out? Read the textbook. Again, you have only at 4 o'clock. Next period is only at 4 o'clock. You spare 10-15 minutes and read your textbook and see whether, because it's very important concept. It can be asked for 3 or 5 marks with the help of the diagram. Explain the Z scheme of light reaction, or explain cyclic and non-cyclic photophosphorylation with the help of diagrams. So it can be asked for essay question also. So please read it. Read it. Not only those who attended, those who did not attend the first period, but for everyone I'm saying, please go through what is given in the textbook. And if you find it difficult to understand what is given, please inform me next period. Okay, 4 o'clock. So you have enough time. At least half an hour you spare. I'm not asking you to learn all those things by heart by 4 o'clock, but read and try to find out which sentence or which part you did not understand. I'll repeat it again. Otherwise, you will find it difficult to follow the remaining topics. Okay. Chemiosmotic hypothesis also not tough, but maybe to understand you will find it difficult, but if you're thorough with this, you will understand it clearly. So please do read and come, especially those who were not absent, in the first period. I might ask you just to know whether you have understood the concept. Okay, so meet you at 4 o'clock. I heard some of you are not, will not be able to attend. They can see the recorded session, and if any doubts, you can even message, as I used to tell, message or call me, or okay, or voice message also you can leave. Thank you, children.
Thank you.